Good morning, everybody. Myself, Srimati H. Asha, Associate Professor, Department of Physics, ADP First Grade College, Harpanhalli. In this video, I'll discuss about Langevin's theory of diamagnetism. Before going in detail with the theory, I would like to share some basic information regarding the magnetic materials. Based on the magnetic properties, the solids are categorized into three categories: diamagnetic substances, paramagnetic substances, and ferromagnetic substances. Diamagnetic substances are said to be non-magnetic in nature. Paramagnetic substances are partially magnetic substances. That is, as long as they are in the external magnetic field, they behave as a magnetic substances. Soon, the external magnetic field is removed. They lose its property. So, they are known as partially magnetic substances. And ferromagnetic substances are strongly magnetic substances. The few properties of the diamagnetic substances are: the diamagnetic substances are independent of the temperature and also the external magnetic field. The susceptibility of the diamagnetic substance is negative. The susceptibility means the capacity to acquire a magnetization when it is placed in an external magnetic field. So the negative sign indicates that however strong you apply an external magnetic field, the substance can never acquire a magnetization. So, the susceptibility of a diamagnetic substance is negative. This is going to be proved in this Langevin's theory. So, in this theory, we are going to consider an electron which is revolving around the nucleus of charge E in a circular orbit of radius r. Let E be the charge of the electron. When the electron is in its circular path, the centripetal force is balanced by the Coulomb's force of attraction, and it is given by the expression mv square by r is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 by r square. In place of v, we are substituting a r omega here, that is the relation between linear velocity and the angular velocity. Q1 is the charge of the nucleus and q2 is the charge of the electron. So this expression will become a mr omega whole square divided by r is equal to z square by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Here we have writing a omega naught here indicating that it's a natural frequency value. So the omega naught square comes out to be z square by 4 pi epsilon naught mr cube. Call this equation number as 1. When this electron is subjected to an external magnetic field, not only it experiences a Coulomb's force of attraction, in addition to this, it is going to experience a Lorentz force, and it is given by the expression EB r omega. Here it is, EB r omega. Minus E indicates that the charge of the electron is negative. So EB r omega. So the total force will be, the centripetal force is balanced by the sum of the Coulomb's force of attraction and this one. So the equation reduces to this form. And taking these two quantities to the left hand side, you can write this equation as a quadratic manner. So here is the form of a quadratic equation, ax square plus bx plus c is equal to 0, where a is 1 from this equation, b is this value, and c we can take it as this. The root of the equation is given by the expression, so we can calculate the root of this equation making use of this relation. We will get this expression as omega is equal to so and so. Now I will write this 2 in the denominator, that is EB by 2m. I will write it instead of the whole denominator by 2. I am going to write this value here so that it will not alter the expression. So taking this to the EB by 2m and taking this 2 inside the root, we can write this expression as this fashion. So 2, when it goes under the root, it becomes 4. So we have written it as 2 under square here, so it becomes 4 here, and the 4 of this one gets cancels with this one, leaving behind the expression in this fashion. So replacing this value with the omega naught square, as in equation number 1, equation 1 I have taken here, so this is nothing but a omega naught square. So replacing this value with omega naught square, and this is written as EB by 2m whole square minus EB by 2m is retained as it is. This value is referred as a Larmor's frequency value, and compared to this natural frequency, Larmor's frequency is very, very small. The Larmor's frequency is nothing but when an electron is subjected to an external magnetic field, the orbits start precessing with a certain frequency in presence of the external field. So that frequency is referred as Larmor's frequency. So compared to natural frequency of the electron, this can be neglected. So the omega naught square under root can be written as omega naught, and this minus Eb by 2m is written here. So this will be the new angular velocity of the electron in presence of the external magnetic field. Now we can calculate a change in angular velocity as delta omega is equal to omega minus omega naught. Substitute the value of omega as the previous equation. From the previous equation you have to substitute here. So the omega naught and omega naught gets cancels, leaving behind delta omega is equal to minus Eb by 2m. Expressing the omega as 2 pi n, so that is 2 pi delta n we are writing, instead of delta omega we are writing it as 2 delta n. This expression will becomes the change in frequency of revolution of the electron is equal to delta n is equal to minus Eb by 4 pi m here. So now we will calculate a magnetic moment of the electron using the formula current into area. Current by definition we can write it as Q by T. So in this value for current I am writing it as this one. So because the Q I have taken it as E here, that is the charge of the electron, and 1 by T is nothing but a frequency. So I have substituted this as the delta N value from my previous equation, delta N is equal to minus Eb by 2m. This I have substituted in place of 1 by T. So this product is nothing but a current here. In place of area I have substituted pi r square. As the electron is moving in a circular path, the circular path radius can be taken as pi r square. The expression reduces to this form. Now we have to calculate the magnetic moment due to the entire atom. As the atom consisting of number of electrons, not all in the same orbits, therefore the magnetic moment of the atom can be replaced as this with a summation sign. This indicates that not all electrons are in the same orbit, so the summation has to be taken for the radius of the orbit. Now if the specimen consisting of n number of atoms per unit volume, then the net magnetization of the specimen can be written as minus nb e square summation of r square by 4m. So in this theory it is taken as summation r square is replaced by 2/3 of r square, in taking into consideration that not all the orbits are always normal to the direction of the magnetic field. So this quantity is replaced by 2/3 of the r square. So the net magnetization expression reduces to this form. Now we can calculate the volume susceptibility of the material as chi is equal to m by h, substituting the value of m in this equation. So this becomes, and replacing this b by mu naught into h and cancelling h and h here, you are going to get this expression as minus mu naught n e square summation r square by 6m. This is the final expression for the susceptibility of the diamagnetic substance. So from this equation it is clear that the susceptibility of the diamagnetic material is negative, as I explained in the beginning of the theory itself, and also it is independent of the absolute temperature, and nowhere you can see the temperature quantity in this final expression, and also the external magnetic field. This clearly indicates that the susceptibility of a diamagnetic material is independent of temperature and external magnetic field, and it is a negative. So that means however strong you apply an external magnetic field, diamagnetic substances will never acquire a magnetization. So this is all about the Langevin's theory of diamagnetism.